Can you say Jesus?
And we've also been doing memory verse, and there's four of them that still remember it, and because they like to try to outdo each other, we're gonna let them do bits and pieces of it.
Therefore, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them,
Praise God.
That it?
No. Awesome, Miss Brandy. You can go back there.
Test. There you go, Brandy.
She said for me to let y'all know that they were from ages 3 to 6. They were adorable. Kids. Ladies, I just am up here to remind you that today is the deadline to get signed up for our Sunday, May 15th at 4 o'clock tea party. So if you would like to get signed up today and buy the $5 ticket, I will be, after service, I will be in the bookstore. This is why we're charging $5. We have some rental fees for the tickets and stuff. So just come see me, and we're really excited to have a good time. And guys, it's a time of outreach. If there's someone that, you know, this is kind of more lighthearted time where if you're working with somebody, you can get them to maybe, hey, come with me to a tea party. It's the mother, daughter, sister, friend tea party. Sister Geraldine and her daughter, Vicki, will be ministering a devotion to us that day. So y'all come out. Oh, where's your hat? If you come, get your hat. We're going to have a hat contest.
If your husband's a tightwad, won't let you spend no money, you can probably get him a Dollar General for about a dollar, okay? So, if you ain't got a dollar, call me and let me know. We'll split it all the way to help you out there. We're excited about, there you go, we're excited about a new ministry we're going to be kicking off in the next couple months. We're going to start it up here real quickly, but it takes a bit of time to get some training and stuff. We're going to start a class called, actually a ministry class, Celebrate the Company here, that's helping with a bunch of different areas in our life. And I've been wanting to get this thing started, but waiting for the staff. I don't know how many folks that ever really did anything correctly. Broke Lake is the straightest that comes. Owen is the straightest that comes. I think Ben pretty well the straightest that comes. So when it comes to people with addictions or problems, they've always kind of come to me, and it kind of wear me out. But thank God we have a good individual here to help us out, and he's going to help us start a ministry, not just a class, a ministry on Celebrate Recovery. And Scott, if you would, why don't you come? He's going to be leading us up here as a minister here on staff with us, just to kick it up and roll with it. And I believe that you're going to be blessed. Scott Mayhoff. I forgot. Was I supposed to do a video after or before? Won't you kick that video right now, Ken, and then we'll let you do it. Let Mr. Scott and...
to pray. Praise God. You know, what my spirit to say to the church today is the Bible says that of the increase of his kingdom there shall be no end. Amen. And so that means that God is always going to be growing his kingdom. He's always going to be expanding his reach and his touch in our individual lives, in the church, and also in the community. And so we with Pastor, I love it that you said you had to wait for somebody to crazy to come along. Praise the Lord. But you know, the young people up here today that were doing the song a minute ago, and that's how we all come to the Lord. Amen. We're all little bitty reborn, you know, babes in Christ, and God has called us to be as He is. Can you say amen? To grow up, amen, to the full measure of the stature of Christ. And but there's always something in our lives that seems to hold us back. And so I'm just believing that God has looked down on this church. We've been very loosely associated with this church for close to 15 years. We live way over on the other side of Salt Lake, and God sent us away on another assignment for a while. But we've watched what God has done in this church over the years, and God has His hands on this ministry. And I believe that God looked at from heaven and He said, now there's a church and there's a pastor and there's the people that I can bring increase to this kingdom in this area. And I believe that God is going to birth Celebrate Recovery. It's going to change hearts in this room. It's going to change the culture of this church, praise God, and it's going to reach this community for Jesus Christ. Again, I'm not going to take a lot of time. Pastor just asked us to kind of introduce ourselves. And so Ray and I are, first and foremost, we're servants of the Lord, amen. We're nobody special. Raven, well, first of all, God delivered me 15, 20 years of drug and alcohol addiction. When I got saved, I was a homeless person on the streets of Memphis. I still remember my reflection in a mud puddle that I drank out of. The Lord has never allowed me to forget that. Amen. How far the devil allowed me to sink down into the depths of destruction. And God said, called me out of that lifestyle. Can't say it's been easy. Been some mistakes over the others. Amen. Praise God. We're none of us are perfect, but God has called us to grow up with Him. And so God called me to ministry at that Raven. Raven and I were actually here when Hurricane Katrina hit. After Hurricane Katrina hit, we went to the Gulf Coast and planted a church in Long Beach, Mississippi. So we're church planters. We pastored that church for about 8 years, Long Beach, called the Way Church. While we were there, we planted and oversaw a Gulf Coast Counseling Center, a free counseling center for the community. We founded and facilitated a campus of international college ministry out of our church. We've done a lot of things for Jesus. This will be our fifth Celebrate Recovery Ministry in Tennessee and in Mississippi. And I said all those things just to tell you that we're here to serve, and we want to, we're the children of it, and we're blessed to be blessed. Can you say amen? Now, Raven, do you want to share a little bit about your life and why God, what God has done in your life?
Yeah, he told me that he would go ahead and do all that for me and that I would just read a scripture, you know. Did you love that? well, you know, I may not have necessarily had a history of drugs and alcohol in my life, but one of the things that God has delivered me from is anxiety, depression, codependency. Those are a lot of things that and not just the body of Christ, but in this community struggle with. And we were talking earlier, but between poverty and depression, and just codependency and anxiety, all the things that seem to be the root issue of a lot of problems in our lives, things that keep us from growing in God, keep us from having the relationship with God that we really, truly desire. And I love that video because it says, you know, I want change, I need help. And, you know, that's what self-recovery is. It's that help that we need, that structure that we need to get to the relationship with God that we really, truly desire.
Amen. Amen. God has done a lot in Raven's life. Raven has been affected by drugs. She was actually sold as a baby for drug money. Amen. When she was a small child, God saved her, saved her mother radically. She traveled all over the United States as a missionary child, a missionary to Indian reservations and things like that. And what I want to say real quick is the celebrate recovery is not just about substance abuse. Amen. In fact, there are 25,000 celebrate recovery groups in the world today. Over 25,000. God is actively working through this discipleship process. This is simply a Christ-centered discipleship process that will allow you to find and walk out the freedom and relationship with Jesus Christ that you've been looking for. Amen. And also help discover your purpose and destiny in the kingdom. God's going to set people free here at Hosanna Church. He's going to set people free in the community in North Mississippi. Amen. He's going to raise up leaders in the kingdom and release the ministry through this program. Amen. Right here for people that are sitting here under Pastor David. Amen. But I want to imprint into the very DNA today this simple understanding. DNA, this celebrate recovery is not just about drugs and alcohol. Only 1/3 of the participants of celebrate recovery are in it for substance abuse. There are also things like family dysfunctions, codependency, physical, emotional, and sexual abuse, relationship addiction, sexual addiction, eating disorder, compulsive behaviors, things like overworking, overeating, abuse, lying, overspending. There's one we all deliverance, grief, guilt, hurtful relationships, rape, divorce, recovery, gambling, anxiety, things like this. Let me say this to you. We all have a common disease, and it's called the disease of sin. It just manifests differently in each one of our lives. So be it with drugs and alcohol. And this is what God wants to say to you today. What is it for you? Amen. What is that one thing, or those multiple things that have been nagging in your life that's holding you back from being everything that you want to be like Jesus? And God says today, you've prayed for deliverance from this. You've prayed for God to set you free from this. You've prayed for God to pull you close to Him. And I hear God saying to you today, planting this program in this church because He wants to bring you up to another level closer to Him. Can you say amen? So, right immediately after church today, we're going to have a little informational meeting out there at the visitor's center. And next Sunday at 5 p.m., we're going to be having a leadership meeting. First thing we're going to roll this out in a few phases, and I'm speaking quick because I'm trying to get done. We're going to roll this out in a few phases. First of all, we're going to raise up a leadership team. I'm believing for 25 people on this leadership team. The size of the foundation of this leadership team will determine how many people we impact in North Mississippi. Amen? So we're believing if you feel like God has called you to do something meaningful in the kingdom of God, be here next Sunday at 5 o'clock. Be out at this information meeting. Be here next Sunday at 5 o'clock. And then we're going to roll out the program to the church community. Amen. And then we really got all the bugs worked out. Praise God. We're seeing some healing and some growth in some of our lives. Then we're going to roll this out of North Mississippi. And then we're going to see God be glorified in the kingdom increase. Can you say amen? Pastor Dayton.
Bro, I am excited about that. Got me geared up here? Or am I off? I am on now, right? Got me? Okay, thank you very much. I am excited about that, to see what God's going to do in this place. Amen? Last week and then over the next couple of weeks, we're going to be talking about relationships. Last week, we talked a little bit about relationships. We found out relationships can be the greatest blessing. It can be the greatest cursing. Anything that has the potential to be good can also have the potential to bring hurt and pain. We talked about last week how most of your hurts and pains that you deal with right now goes back somewhere to a broken relationship. We talked about also that the joy, excitement you have in life, you can trace it back to what happened with that relationship with somebody. In other words, what if you was an island of yourself? It takes people to be able to bring the best out of you. In short, relationships is a place of perfection. In other words, God brings you in as you begin to build relationships with other people. It brings you to a place of maturity, because building relationships with people usually exposes areas of our life that we need to change. Today we're going to be talking about a few other things. I want to share something that we never shared really about myself today, to help you understand how things work in your heart and brain and your mind. You may not understand why they operate, but they're there. And I'm going to use just a little example in just a minute about myself and how that belief system in my life restricts the blessings of God on my personal life, restricts the blessings of God on my family's life, also restricts the blessings of God on this person's life. And so I'm going to share with you the things that God helped you to see recently. You know, once you begin to live, realize the love and grace of God, know He ain't out to get you, it informs how your heart just opens up and says, God works in areas that I didn't even know I had issues with. I know God's going to come and beat me up. God's going to come and gently love me and encourage me to talk to me. And I think God is able to do that in the name of the Lord. Amen. Serving God is also going to get past the unfamiliar. Let me say that again. Serving God is often when we get past the unfamiliar. The word seek equilibrium or equilibrium means this right here. A state with opposing forces or influences are balanced. Our mind, if you don't mind, just leave that up there a little bit. Our mind is amazing. Anytime our mind or heart tries to get outside of its basic belief system, equilibrium sits here. In other words, something from the outside tries to come in and bring you back into balance to what you believe. If you believe you're going to be poor your whole life, when God sends a blessing your way, guess what you will do? You will set equilibrium. You will set out to stop God, the blessings of God in your life. I've seen people time and time again, God begins to do something in their life because they feel unworthy of what God wants to do. Somehow, someway, they sacrifice the very thing that God wants to do in their life. Our mind seeks to keep us bound to the permission. And before you get too religious from me, say, just talk about this heart and mind business. I've been doing this for 30 years. I used to preach heaven so high you pull hair off of your head. I used to yell and scream at people telling they're going to bust hell wide open. And that's not good sometimes, but at the end of the day, people are wanting to know, help me out of this situation. So instead of letting you indulge me, I come to the place in my life, I want to help you out. I want to help you grow in the name of the Lord. See, living within boundaries, our mind will set up to convince you that you need to stay away from, you need to keep that back job. You're not good enough to get another job. And your brain will set up, you're going to be just the way you are, just the way you are, and that's not God's plan. Our mind will set up to tell you that you're never going to be happy. You just deserve where you're at, you just be with you the rest of your life. And somehow, somewhere, we begin to breathe it to so much that it begins to make sense in our life. Most of our poor flesh, in right here, most of our poor flesh were established when you were children. Most of the things that you based your life on right now go back to something that happened, whether good or bad, when you were a child. You've heard me talk about this a lot. Our brain is into continued what they call a meta state. In other words, it's continually taking in information to find significance with. Maybe you were raised in a home where a man abused your mother, so it's like your brain somehow you set out and you decided that that's just how men are. So when one of them abused you, you just kind of fall in line with it because somehow, somewhere, your brain is set out to prove that that's just how life's going to be. The good news, some people were raised in a godly home and a godly influence, and guess what? When all the world says you can't be it, that doesn't determine in their heart and brain. They have in their mind determined, yes, I can be blessed. Because they learned the stories of David and Goliath. They learned the stories of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. They learned all the stories, but they begin to go into a struggle. Their mind begins to tell them they can't. The Spirit of God within them begins to say they can't, so they succeed. So some people's successes and some people's failures lots of times are based upon some of the things that we learn as a child. My dad was a wonderful man. And I'm not here to degrade my dad. I'm just going to talk a little bit about what went on a little bit in my life. My dad was a wonderful man. Full of compassion. My dad loved helping people. When I was 10 years old, to a place called Turnerville. Turnerville was a place where there was a dump. You can talk to the county of the city. How many of y'all remember dumps when y'all were little? The dumps were big trucks. Big trucks come in to dump the trash. They dump the dogs off. They dump all that off and stuff. Fire continually burning. And so every day of my life, I drove past a place out there called it was a dump. And all my life, I've seen those people. I can remember pulling our truck up back and throwing the trash off into the dump. And those families that we lived there turned real with kids and dig out and try to find stuff. Try to find food, try to find stuff in that trash. And that's how, in a sense, how I think. My dad was always had compassion on people. If somebody needed a little bit of money, my dad would send me a $20 bill. If they needed more money, he would take their gun and say, "This money, and you can pay me back, I'll give you a gun back." So my dad's mindset was always have compassion for the poor. How many know if you have compassion for the poor? My dad's dad had killed me himself. Mom sent on a story he tells me. His mama sent him a tape, cigarette in his mouth, and said, "You're going to be the man from this point on." He was the oldest of the sons. At the age of 7 years old, cigarette in his mouth, "You're now the oldest person in this family. You're the man in this house." My dad started living on the streets as a young man, as a taxi cab dispatcher at the military base. After a while, didn't feel sorry for him, so a very wealthy man in the area brought him into his house. And he'd sit down and he'd say, "Son," he actually come back and meet in that house later when we got older. I got to be a teenager, and he'd say, "Son, I was making up this old man and telling me I didn't have a daddy. It's making me feel bad." He said, "I have never liked people." He was the one loaning money to the poor people. Ain't that kind of strange? He never liked people. He said, "Son, that's why I'm a Democrat." He goes, "I just start to give money to the poor and it can give it to those rich people because those rich people are stepping on the back of the poor people." These are the things my daddy constantly bombarded and put in my mind. I won't tell you some of the other things my dad used to tell me. I put it on Facebook the other day. But that was the stuff that I come up with. As a result of those things that my dad taught me, it restricted the blessings of God in my life, in my family's life, and the church's life. Imagine afraid of being blessed because someone or somebody else thinks about it. Imagine God wanting to bless me, but because I had a mindset that if I'm blessed, people like myself are going to judge me and say, "He must have stepped on somebody's back to be able to be blessed." Now, you're showing. Imagine that pastor up there driving a new truck, living in that big old house. What does he need money for? He should just give it to those that are in need. I know people repeatedly say that stuff about me here, not knowing that I physically built my own house. But I've listened to people tell me, "All they do is want your money up there." He said, "That big old house he's living in, he's taking from the poor where he can have what he has." So based upon those fears and those teachings at a young child's life, I always had a fear that I bless too much, because if I bless too much, that people will think that I'm robbing from people. Those mega church pastors, those TV preachers, all they do is take money from the poor and from old people. Proverbs 29:25 says this way: "The fear of man brings a snare, but whoever trusts in the Lord shall be saved." The word fear means anxiety, quaking, trembling, extreme anxiousness of God. Imagine stuff that your father taught you at a young age, things that you learned at a young age. God died where we could be blessed, but because we have listened to the people around us, and we've listened to the people of our friends and family and what we raised, and we choose to live in poverty, or choose to live poor, rather than being blessed out of fear of man and man's opinions. Out of fear of fear, our teamwork and struggle for success. Out of fear of people's opinions. Out of fear inside, I would worry about growing too fast. But if I grow too fast, I'll fall like all other preachers did in the early 90s. Out of fear, I would not push people for money, because I didn't want you to think I was wanting money. And in all reality, I was restricting you from getting blessed and money gifts to the kingdom of God. Out of fear of what people think. Out of fear of somebody posting something on Facebook. All they do is want your money. But it's not godly. Jesus Christ, by God, be blessed. The problem is, we are afraid to be blessed. Traveling a little ahead of myself. Remember a couple weeks ago when I said some of us are afraid to be blessed, fearful that we go back to the old lifestyle? I had a lot of people lining up secretly coming and talking to me before they went out of fun. Now, that's me, but I'm fearful to be blessed. I'm scared that if I begin to be blessed, I'll go back into my old lifestyle. That sounds honorable. It sounds good, but that is restricting what God wants for you. I heard somebody say, man, I haven't had enough money. I give it away. Well, then you're not very smart either. God don't want you to be where you can give it all away. God wants you to be a blessing where you can be a blessing, but God wants you to be wise. It's honorable to sound like it's okay to be poor. But that's not God's for you. Listen to this right here. Our normal, whether we like it or not, is something that we have accepted. If you're a part of today, let's know that it is something that you have accepted and chose. If you got addictions running in your life, it is something that you have chose and are willing to accept as normal in your life. If you're not living a mediocre life, it is because somewhere, some back in your brain, you think that this mediocre is okay. Remember, until we under rest in the finished work of Christ, we will always always be more apt to believe in just our logical thinking rather than what God wants. It corrupts our beliefs. Hebrews 4:11-13 says, let us therefore be diligent to enter into rest, lest anyone fall according to the example of disobedience. For the word of God is living and powerful, and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even the division of the soul of the spirit, and joints of the marrow, and the discerner and the thoughts of the heart. The word of God is what comes in. When we understand who we are in Christ, in Christ, the word of God will come and begin to penetrate belief systems that are keeping us back. And people just live in sickness and choose, that's just the way I'm going to live. That's what's just part of my life. And people just satisfied. You know what, probably one of the most selfish things I know? To choose to stay poor. One of the most selfish things I know, when God give us the blessings of Abraham in our life, for me to stay poor while I can't be a blessing to other people. That is probably one of the most, in fact, that's a stench in the nostrils of God. Why would a person want to stay in poverty? Why would a person want to stay in addiction? Why would a person want to stay in belief systems that's restricting the blessings of God? Deuteronomy 8:18-20 says this, and you shall remember the Lord your God, for it is he gives you the power to get wealth. Let me just stop there real quickly. Not everybody that is blessed in life stepped on people's back to be blessed. Because the scripture says right there, it is he who gives you the power to give wealth, that he may establish his covenant which he swore to your fathers. See, God wants you blessed where you can establish his covenant. God wants you to be blessed where you can establish the covenant. We let the world know you deserve God. Remember the song the kids were just singing? After about the first verse, they started, Jesus loves me. Now, that's what's happening to some of you right now. You just don't, your brain is trying to tell you right now. Some of you right now are trying to tell you that what I'm saying. You're trying to reason in your heart and mind why what I'm saying is not truthful for you. Right now, some of you, right now, you have done detached yourself from what I'm trying to say and choosing to believe. Your brain right now is sitting down and looking in your brain. You're trying to figure out right now. Because you used to say, just get inside the front gate. It don't matter if I got a mansion, hallelujah, if I can just make it right on the inside and live in a tent. Well, why would God allow one person to live in a mansion and allow you just to live in a tent? It wasn't his effort to get him a mansion, and it ain't your effort to get you a tent. It's the effort of Jesus Christ for you to be blessed, and we need to learn to choose to live under those circumstances. Look what he says. Then it shall be, if you by any means forget the Lord your God and follow after other gods and serve them and worship them, I will testify against you this day, and you shall surely perish. That's where most people get it from, and that's right, that's our covenant. In the Old Testament, it was a common cycle for people to be blessed and then fall back and sin. Read the book of Judges. Get blessed, fall back in sin. Get blessed, fall back in sin. I have seen it. I have seen married couples that their life is messed up completely. I have seen them come in this church, get blessed, get the Bible, and then all of a sudden, for some reason, they don't feel like that they need to be in church on Sunday. And all of a sudden, they don't feel like they don't need to be in small groups. Now, in other words, they begin to trust in themselves that everything's okay. And I've seen them time after time begin to fall. I've seen people, God, deliver them of addictions. You know what? And they begin to find 1,000 reasons why they don't need to be in the house of God in the physical world. Psalm 24 says, yes, I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. Guess what? I will fear no evil. If God has delivered you, you don't have to fear the evil one. You don't have to fear that business. You can trust in the promises of God. That was yesterday, no, and I'll continue getting on them. Scored a 24 on the ACT. Come on, man. If I scored a 24 on ACT, I've been working to get on. Man, it's because I didn't support always knew that. I was way, way below. But my Lord, it's just smart. Try to be everything out there. Try to be the best that you can be. You're not going to get away with that around me. You score high on ACT, and you tell me you want to be a well digger. I'm going to tell you, baby, you need to be a little bit smarter than a well digger. Thank God for well diggers, because we wouldn't have no water. But you know what? If we go run the well digging business, go get a degree in business where you can run the business instead of being a well digger business person. See, I don't like hearing that. You choose to live in the lifestyle that you choose to. Just like I did, unknowingly choose to live in poverty. Unknowingly choose to live from crisis to crisis. Rather than be blessed. If you have your Bibles, go to 1 John chapter 3, verses 4. Let's read a couple of things. I want to try to lay a principle out for you. First John chapter 3, verse 4. Yeah. Whosoever committeth sin and transgresses also the law. So sin is the transgression of the law. If you don't find, don't bring the definition of sin up. So what is sin here? The law, the standard giving. When you did not all the laws, you have now missed the mark. I don't care if you obey 99 of them. When you messed up on one, you have missed the mark. Y'all got that? Hear me? Sin is to the rest of the law. Also, do this and you shall live. If you broke one of them, Scripture says you're guilty of all of them. You're used to that kind of stuff. We're used to missing the mark. We all kind of know the feeling of missing the mark because we're all messed up. So we know that feeling of missing the mark. Look what the next part of it is. To miss the mark and not share in the prize. Why don't we feel just as bad for not sharing in the prize as we do about missing the mark? Easy for us, but for some reason, mainly in the South. I'm coming up on the rough side of the mountain. So I'm glad when this life is over. Plowing just a few more weary days, and then I fly away. Y'all keep hanging on with me. Let's look at something. See, most people get missing the mark. You get that you messed up. But what about the blessing of God? What about the prize? What about the prize? Galatians 3:13 through 14 said, Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, having become a curse for us, for the tree touches everyone who hangs on a tree, that the blessings of Abraham might come upon the Gentiles by reason. Okay, you're a Gentile, by the way. Just to say, a Gentile in Christ, that we might receive the promise of the Holy Spirit through faith. Now let me ask you something. When Jesus died, what was the promise to give us back? The promise was the Holy Spirit of God that lives in us. Now, y'all hang on. The promise was the Holy Spirit of God living in us. Let me ask you something. Was Abraham blessed because he knew he had a bunch of cattle and his name was great and all that? Well, that is the byproduct of the favor of God. God pronounced that blessing over him and pronounced the what God wanted over him, he began to walk in it and he began to be blessed in it. And that's, you know, God's spoken some things over you. Let's keep on going. How many of you believe? Now, we're fixing to get into some stuff here because I'm here to challenge your belief system. How many of y'all believe that we serve a God of purpose? Now, we don't understand, you know, I don't fade them around here and things because I believe it should be the norm. We had a lady with a tumor in the knee, had cancer. They took her in this past month, and she wrote a testimony about the healing before she even got there and give it to us before they redid the MRI, and that's no longer a cancer or tumor in the knee. But look at it. That kind of stuff should be the norm with us. And there's a lot of us, oh, I just don't go crazy because that should be the norm of our life. But it is right here. How many of y'all believe we serve a God of miracles? How many of you would rather personally live a life of miracles or the blessed life? You say that? How many of y'all would rather live the life of miracles or the blessed life? Let's just raise your hand. How many of y'all would rather live a life of miracles? No, just be quiet. It's really not a trick. It's not a trick question. It exposes our hearts. I'm going to say it again. How many of you would rather live a life? I'm not going to put you down. I'm just going to tell you the truth. How many of you would rather live a life of miracles? See, you're not stop me. Now, you done started something, woman. Be quiet. Be silent and meek unto the Lord. How many of y'all would rather live the blessed life? Miracles? Blessed life. All right, let's talk about it. What is a miracle? What is a miracle? A miracle is a suspension or superseding natural laws. It's when God comes in, says your arm is broke, the natural law says it's broke, but God comes in and provides a miracle that will supersede what actually looks bad and make it right. How many of y'all ever been in a financial need and needed a miracle for God to come through? So God, I need a miracle. Remember this right here. All miracles are unnatural. They are temporary and they are never permanent. Miracles are temporary. It's not temporarily superseding the natural to bring that which is supernatural into the natural. But it's always temporary. Would you rather live in the temporary or the permanent? Let me say it again. Would you rather live from miracle to miracle to miracle, or would you rather live in a blessed state? You're living from miracle to miracle. It's probably if you're living from crisis to crisis. Thank God for miracles when we're living from crisis. We have been living from crisis to crisis here at this church. It sounds good, and we can shout hallelujah when it happens, but that's not what God wants for this church, and that's not what God wants for you. God wants you to be blessed. God wants the church to be blessed. Instead of us living from miracle to miracle, thank God for miracles. But God is going to live the blessed life for you. God wants to be the miracle. I want to pray for people that you
I want to believe God with me a miracle.
But I'd rather live in a life that is blessed because of the blessings of Abraham are on my life.
See, if we believe we are blessed and actually accordingly, we will avoid many of the problems that make us candidates for a miracle.
Let me read that again. If we believe we are blessed and begin to act accordingly, we will avoid many of the problems that make us candidates for a miracle in our lives.
Some believers pray for financial miracles, but aren't practicing the principles that produce the blessed life.
I have starved y'all, and I have restricted y'all, and I put you out of here. Out of fear of men, out of fear of preachers that preach about you.
I remember I went and bought a four-door small Nissan because I didn't want nobody to think that having a big vehicle, I was bigger, so we got this little Ford Nissan. Make me look a little bit more humbler. It got worse gas mileage. It cost more money driving that thing than it did a Ford truck.
Because people around here would look at me driving a truck and I would go back to the equilibrium, I think. They trying to think I'm taking poor people's money. They trying to, I'm stepping on poor people. I can drive.
Look at me. If you got money, the Bible says save. It said, look to your hands. See, some of God knows that you'd get foolish with it and go crazy spending it.
Another thing, if you're going to be blessed, you got to work.
I like what T.D. Jakes said. He says you should work. Only meant 1 out of 7 days of working. God only rested 1 out of 7. That means the other 6 days, we need to be getting out there working and believing God to bless the hands of our labor.
Now we have to drop to Ireland. Down to 30 hours a week.
How about being wise? It took me a lot of years to be wise right here. Because I'm telling you, we receive about 5 to 20 phone calls a week from people in these months.
If I ever slip up and you get me on a weak moment, and I give you money, there will be 15 phone calls because that person's done passed it down to everybody else.
I think my number's permanently printed somewhere in Skyline Motel because it's not just a problem calls up to the church.
And I want to be a blessing to the poor. We want to help the poor. But if we don't teach the people how to be blessed, this is going to be a repeated money that you come to get.
But buddy, if you would ever believe in your heart that I am blessed, God wants me to be blessed. He wants to favor God. I'm tired of working from miracle to miracle. I want to begin to live the blessed life. If you can begin to believe that, it's not dependent upon nobody.
And worse, if you can begin to believe that that's what God wants for you, then you really will begin to live the blessed life.
What is the blessed life?
Again, the blessed life wasn't Abraham getting things. The blessed life was the spoken word, the favor of God. that was pronounced over him. He said, "Now, Abraham, I'll make you great. I'll bless those that bless you and curse those that curse you. I'll make your name great." All these things what God spoke over Abraham. He didn't have to do none of that, did he? God spoke it over him. And when he began to believe God, it was accounted unto him as righteousness. So the blessings of God are not things. The blessings of God is the favor of God in your life. It's not how much money you got. It's when you go for a job for a job. The favor of God rests on you. It's me believing that God wants this for me as much as he wants it. He's not a respecter of persons. It's okay for this church to succeed. It's okay for us to have large numbers.
I told my children, "Man, don't you be bringing no thug up my house. I don't work myself to death to make sure you have a blessed life. Don't you dare. You bring somebody in here, work. It's got a mindset to be blessed. Don't you have one with a poor mentality. And if you're poor right now, you got 365 days to begin to bless every day. Work yourself right on out of this year, okay? And look at this. Be a work. I ain't trying to talk. I'm going to talk to you. You just got to know. I got to know it's okay. If I'm driving a nice vehicle or living in my house, I ain't got to walk about worrying about the opinion of man, because the opinion is from the chair. It's never going to tell you all what's worried about what people think. Favor of God on my life. Do you? I believe you do. When I stand up and preach, I want the favor of God on my life. When I coach, I want the favor of God on my life. Somebody asked me to share with something, I want the favor of God on my life. I want people to look at me and say, "Man, there's something different about him." I don't care if I look like a preacher, I want to say, "There's something about them." I want, if I'm back working on something, I come out and I got old, long, and I say, "Man, I'm the pastor. I ain't worried about what somebody says about me." I'll be different. Yeah, I know y'all think Brother Raper's the pastor, but I'm really the pastor, you know. Just ain't dressed like it. Real quickly, three reasons for receiving from God through blessings rather than miracles. Three real simple ones. Number one, blessings prevent crisis while miracles deliver from crisis. Let's say that again. Blessings prevent crisis. Wouldn't you be honest with you, wouldn't you just like to be able to pull up and pay for your own gas instead of to beg somebody? Really, come on. Wouldn't you like to just walk up? Isn't it easier for you to believe God to be blessed than to believe God for you, somebody to give you $1 million? Wouldn't it be just as easy for you to be blessed like that? To believe, it takes just as much energy for you to believe to be blessed than to believe God will give you something. It takes just as much faith. Number two, a blessing is always more abundant supply than a miracle. Because a blessing is coming from repeated abundance through what Jesus Christ has already done. Number three, miracles are temporary fix while blessings are a permanent solution. Let me read that again. Miracles are a temporary fix while blessings are a permanent solution. I want to be blessed. I am blessed. But I want to not restrict anything from my life. When it comes to healings, I don't want to restrict it. When it comes to, I don't want to restrict any of that. I want unbelief out of my heart and mind. And what God has done for Damon, and it took him 30 years, but he's peeled layer of layer off of my life
gently to show me and expose. Drugs is no more issue for me. But you know what? I had deeper issues than the drugs. Chasing women is no longer an issue with me because I had deeper issues than that. It was stuff I learned as a child. I had deeper issues than all that. And it's taken all these years for God to gently pull back the layers in my life. And guess what? It scares me on one part what it looks like. But on the other side, my Lord, if I'm restricting the blessings of God, gently pulling back, you know what it's all about. And that's where you ought to be. God, here I am. I know you love me. You're not going to die. You're not going to pull me down. But whatever it is that I've had in my life that is restricting from your best in my life, Lord, you know I can handle it, take it out. I want to live a blessed life. I want my children to be blessed. I want everything about it. I want my family to be sanctified because I'm sanctified and all these things. Instead of choosing to live in poverty because it sounds holy, it feels holy, but it's against the very blessings of God. Our prayer should be, Lord, help me to never need a miracle from you again. You hear that? Lord, help me to never need a miracle from you again. I want to live with you. The good news is you're all blessed. Bad news is most of us don't know the power of that blessing because of our unbelief. In last conclusion, the fear of man and the fear of failure restrict the favor of God on our life. It keeps us in the temporary, living from crisis to crisis. I'm going to rejoice with you when you get a miracle. But if you think I want you to live in that state, I just don't. And you can criticize me. You can go to the church outside here and criticize me. You can tell people that all I want is the poor people's money and the old people's money. You can do that if you want to. But I believe some of you in here know that I love Jesus. And I believe some of you know here that I turmoiled and went through 30 years. And if it's got me to the point that I can finally teach you how to be blessed, then I'm willing to do it in the name of the Lord. Because this church needs to be a lighthouse to this community. And we can't do it from crisis to crisis. And I didn't preach this message where I could start preaching about money you next Sunday. No, get that off your head. But God wants to bless you. Now let me ask you this question again. How many of y'all would like to live with daily miracles or daily blessings? Y'all get it? So many of us, we live from crisis to crisis. Paycheck to paycheck. I get it. I've been like, oh my God, the bill come on the 30th, do I deposit that check at my checking account? 4 o'clock? The whole time get my check in there by Monday? Let it down. I don't know how the bank do it. I drop it in there like $3.59 and it still draws from my account. I'm like, y'all supposed to close in a minute. How in the world did you just pull out of my account money and now I've got it bounced? What is $37? I don't live like that. But I want to be wise enough that when God blesses me, I keep seed to myself. Don't just get rid of everything. So it ain't so much about being rich, it's about learning how to handle when God gives you the blessing instead of being unwise, because that's another whole story. You feel good about yourself when you give everybody. That way you can be a hero. Oh, Brother Damon, he's awesome. He did this. Now you're not trusting in the blessings of God. You trust in what people are saying about you. Okay? Y'all get it? How do we do this altar call? Look at me. I don't want to go too far old school here. And I know some of you are going to think I'm retarded. Oh, I hadn't seen this in 20 years, Brother Rafer. 30 years. But if you're really here, just the blessings of God in your life, you want to begin to start it. I'm going to do it. We're going to do a tunnel. This is what we used to years ago. It would be a tunnel. People would accept it. And if you needed a miracle, as you walk through the tunnel, people would be praying for you. Now, if you knew here, I have never done this in 20 years here because I worry about you. But if you're here, if you want to begin to live the best life, the favor of God on your life, Brother Rayford, some of you people have been blessed, Brother Rayford, Tracy, some of you, why don't y'all just stand in line here? Some of you people that have been blessed in life, why don't you stand here? Stand here. I need some more people. I need some people that have been blessed. And I'll tell you what I want you to do. Yeah, because they're going to walk through with you. I know y'all going to think I'm corny, and that's okay. You know what? I'm not worried about them. But if you're here and you want to begin to live the blessed life, what I want you to do is get up, maybe you and your wife, whatever, and I want you to be a single black mother, three kids. Listen to me. She's been 15 notches of being the number one seller in Mary Kay. So if you need to stick by something from her here, that's what get number one is in that tie that goes down, okay? Look at me. I know you think it's impressed. I know it. If you want to begin to be blessed, you just begin to walk through here, wherever you may be. Come on, y'all be praying for it in the name of come on, y'all be blessed. Lord, we bless you. Come on, God. I believe it. In Jesus' name, Lord God. Bless them abundantly. Come on. The blessed life, Lord. I don't want to seem foolish, but Lord, we want you to bless like her and her children, everybody, Lord. The blessed life, in the name of God. No longer afraid of man. No longer afraid of man, God. No longer afraid of man, Lord God. Bless. No longer afraid of man, Lord God. If you could pull the music up. Bless, Lord God. Bless, Lord God. I'm on deathbed, still alive. Hear me? Bless, Lord God. Bless them, God, abundantly. Bless them. Let them have a mindset of being blessed, Lord God, abundantly. Let them have a mindset of, I'm going to be blessed. No longer in poverty. I'm going to be blessed in the name of God. Bless, oh God. Bless them, God. Bless them, Jesus. I know God is blessing you. Wind and mercy.